Good morning. It is great to see the fathers and their sons and daughters. So we especially welcome you this morning. Glad that you got up early. I don't know what dad or granddad had to do to get you here, but I hope it's worth it because I hope God will speak to your heart as he does to all of us every Thursday morning. But it is a delight to have you. The last several weeks, we've been doing a series on Joseph, the earthly father of Jesus, the forgotten man of Christmas. We don't do a lot of talking about Joseph. It's a lot of attention, of course, on Mary and baby Jesus and even Herod and wise men and shepherds. But what about Dad? What about Joseph? And I want to play a song for you this morning, and it's become my favorite Christmas song because of the story behind it. Henry Wadsworth Longfellow wrote a song entitled, "I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day," and probably everybody has heard that, but you may not know the story behind it. And the little video that I'm going to show, Jeff's going to show here, will tell you the story behind it. But the story is about a dad who is very depressed because of what has happened in his life the previous 2 years. And when we go through bad times and hard times, we wonder where God is and how we're going to get through this, how's things going to work. And there's two stanzas in the song that I want to draw your attention to. The words on the back of your notes there. He gets down in kind of the core part of the beginning of the song in the midst of his despair as he hears the Christmas bells, is he says, "And in despair, I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men, of peace on earth, goodwill to men." And if the song ended right there, it would be tragic, would it not? But he continues to hear the bells, and then he concludes, "Then peal the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail, with peace on earth, goodwill to men." May you hear the voice of God through the story and the song.
It was a long, cold winter of 1863. The war between the states raged mercilessly. Antietam, Vicksburg, Gettysburg, Chickamauga. Sons, fathers, and brothers from Mississippi to Maine had not come home for Christmas, and many would never return. Poet Henry Wadsworth Longfellow sat in Cambridge, Massachusetts, pondering the state of the world around him. Longfellow had been widowed for 2 years since his wife's dress tragically caught fire, and his son, Charles, was now seriously wounded, having been injured on December 1st by a Confederate bullet at the Battle of New Hope Church. As he sat nursing his son on the long road to recovery, listening to the church bells pealing forth Christmas tidings, he struggled with the message of the angels proclaiming, "Peace on earth, goodwill towards men." And he took up his pen and wrote.
Are ringing.
Amen, amen, amen. I just want to say this before I quote the verse that we always start with. We don't know what's ahead of us. We don't know what 2020 holds. You don't know where you're going to be. I don't know where I'm going to be. You don't know where your family's going to be, where any of us are going to be. And whether we look ourselves in the mirror or we're looking at our country and our world as a whole, there's only one place to find peace. And his name is Jesus. That song has never been more true. Again, it was written by a father in the midst of grieving and sadness and tragedy. And he works through a process in his journal. He's writing this in his journal, writing a song, writing a poem. And he concludes, there is peace. And his name is Jesus. Don't forget that. Merry Christmas. Be on the alert. Stand firm in your faith. Act like men. Be strong. That's 1 Corinthians 16:13. And for all the sons and daughters here this morning, we start that. We start our time together with that verse. For 13 years now, we're going on 13 years, we've been trying to figure out what act like a man means. We've been teasing it out. And right now, we're doing a study on Joseph, the forgotten man of Christmas. I want you to pick up your notes and follow with me. And let me read the introductory paragraph. Gives you a little bit of an overview of what we're looking at. Joseph, the earthly father of Jesus as a model for manhood. Joseph is the forgotten figure of the Christmas story. He stands silent. He is spoken to and he is spoken about, but not a single syllable crosses his lips. Now, sons and daughters, you may wish that was the case with your dad. Your dad maybe talks too much, or maybe you wish he would talk more. Joseph never said a word that we have recorded in Scripture. He is viewed at best as just a bit player, an extra in the Christmas drama. He's been pushed aside, and yet he is vitally important because of what God said to him and what God did through him. His faith, his courage, his strength, his sensitivity, his compassion, his devotion, his determination, his foresight, and his obedience to the will of God actually have a greater impact on Christian thought and on the Christian lifestyle than we have been willing to acknowledge. And then we've been using our imagination a little bit. Imagine Joseph comes for counseling. What would that sound like? Now, what I want you to do as we look at Joseph for a few minutes, and then I'm going to have you draw a diagram. I want you to answer a question. And dads and granddads, I want you to ask your sons and daughters this question. What makes a good dad? And if you're not sitting by a son or daughter and you're just sitting by a friend, ask them that. Ask the one sitting next to you, what makes a good dad? And listen to what your sons and daughters say to you. Guys, ask the question. Hey, man. Good to see you, dude. Good to see you, man. Good to see you.
Hey,
man. Good to see you. All right. Now you can continue that conversation in the car driving home. But let me ask the sons and the daughters to work with me here. And what makes a good dad? Just yell it out. Consistency. Consistent. Passion. Got to eat health food. All right. Watch what he eats. That's right. What was that? Okay. All right. He knows how to say no to protect you. How's that? Isn't that cool? Yeah. He doesn't let you get into stuff that you don't need to be getting into. Love. Okay. All right. There we go. We got love. He's loving. Kindness. There we go. He's kind. Very good. All right. Time. And what was this one? There we go. Time, he spends time with you. So it's time. Very good. He's with me. And that's an important phrase. Now, I'm going to actually put that way up here. That is so cool, because that's so much of what Jesus says to us. I'm with you. I'm with you. I'm with you. I'm with you. Because he helps you. Very good. All right. Thank you, Colin. All right. A good dad. Joseph was the dad that Jesus learned obedience from. The scripture says in Hebrews that Jesus learned obedience by the things that he experienced. What was going through Jesus' life from birth until 30 years old? We don't know a whole lot. We know a small episode in the temple when he was younger. But for the most part, he was just hanging out with dad as a carpenter. In Matthew chapter 1 and in Matthew chapter 2, there's more given to us in those passages, and I've included those on the back of your notes, and I don't have time to read the passages, but that's what your dad and your granddads have been studying for the last couple of weeks, is these passages about Joseph. And Joseph, in these four episodes that God speaks to him in a dream, helps us understand four critical areas of life. The four areas that Joseph really modeled as a good dad for Jesus, that he was a good dad for Jesus, is, first of all, he helped Jesus and Jesus's mother understand shame. When we first are introduced to Joseph, Joseph is betrothed, a Middle Eastern word, which means a kind of a second stage of engagement, and he was to be engaged to Mary. And the passage says that Mary is pregnant. She's going to have a child, but they're not married. And Joseph was confused. What was he to do? It's like you can imagine Joseph coming into my counseling room. I'm a counselor. And Joseph comes into my counseling room and he says, she's pregnant. I thought I could trust her. And then I think she's kind of psychotic or something, because now she's telling me that she's pregnant by spirit. I think she's lost her mind. And then, in the way God does it, he speaks to Joseph. God ever spoken to you? I hear him every day. I've never heard him audibly, but he speaks to me in my heart. He speaks to me when I read his word. God speaks. He's talking all the time. And he spoke to Joseph in a dream and he said, Joseph, what Mary is telling you is true. Don't be afraid. Marry her. Protect her. And Joseph comes to Mary and he indicates to Mary that he's going to protect her like a good dad, like a good husband. And he spoke right in to the shame. People in the village would have been talking about Mary, possibly even wanting to stone Mary. She's lying. What would her dad, what would her mom have said to her? Mary, you've disgraced us. And Joseph said, no. God has spoken to my heart. He's calmed my heart. I listen to God. I'll protect you, Mary. And he braces Mary and fights through the shame. And then a little later on in Matthew, after Jesus is born, Joseph gets word that Herod is threatened by King Jesus. He knows that the Jews are talking about the Messiah coming, King Jesus. And so Herod was expecting some guy with lots of pomp and circumstance to come. And he gets word through three wise men who have come to visit Jesus and are on their way back to their country that Jesus has been born. And Herod is so threatened, he figures out the region that he must be in. And the research shows us that as Herod is ready to go and kill all the male babies that were born in this time frame, that probably on that night and that time period, there was more than 30 babies that were killed because Herod was trying to kill Jesus. 30 babies died because Jesus was born. And Joseph was told in another dream, second dream, to pick up his family and move to Egypt. And Joseph, in the midst of feeling confusion and rejection, moves to Egypt. Now, again, imagine Joseph coming into my counseling office and he said, you know, I've got this new baby. I married Mary and we're so happy. I'm good, Joseph. I'm glad. Glad you're happy. What'd you name him? Oh, we named him Jesus because that's what we were told to name him by God. Good. Keep listening to God. Listen to God. Listen to God. And then Herod's trying, we've gotten word that Herod the king is trying to kill him. Kill our baby boy. Wants to kill our baby boy. But God spoke to me in another dream and he told me to move to Egypt. When I said, Egypt, why would God want you to move to Egypt? And Joseph said, exactly. Exactly. Why would I move to Egypt? And then if I could pull up my Bible understanding, I might say, you know, I think God's up to something here. He's going to take you back to a place where your ancestors were enslaved as a symbolic move to show once again that the only way to be free is to believe in Jesus. Peace comes through Jesus. And he's going to bring you out of Egypt. Don't be afraid. Go. And so Joseph, in the midst of feeling rejected, like, you got to move. I've got a new baby and I got to move. I'm losing my job. I can't keep making tables and chairs as a carpenter. And he moves to Egypt. Joseph shows us that a good dad knows how to face rejection and continue to protect his family. So he's in Egypt. He's in Egypt. He's in a foreign country. This is not home. He wants to go home. Doesn't everybody want to be home for Christmas? I mean, what if you knew that you couldn't be home for Christmas? You couldn't be with Dad. You couldn't be with Mom. We couldn't be with our families. that would be sad in and of itself. We all want to be home for Christmas. And so Joseph is in Egypt, and he is learning a life lesson, how to deal with good and bad at the same time, because that's what healthy people do. They're able to understand the good things and say, thank you, God. And they're able to deal with hard things, because life is going to be hard. Life is hard. We call it here in our men's group, flowers and weeds. There's always flowers and there's always weeds. And Joseph is in Egypt, and God comes to him in another dream. And he says, Herod has died. Take the baby. Take your wife. You can leave Egypt. Wow. Symbolic. Once again, God's provision comes out of Egypt in order to receive God's blessing. That's what happened hundreds of years before in redemptive history. And Joseph models for us what good and bad is. And then fourth and finally, Joseph has come into his homeland, but he doesn't quite know where to go. And so God comes to him in a fourth dream and speaks to him and says, go to Nazareth. You'll be safe in Nazareth. And Joseph's hope is restored. Hope. You can't live without hope. But hope is not so much about your future. Hope is about looking over your shoulder and seeing what God has done in the past and remembering what God has done in the past in order to have fuel for the future. Isn't that cool? And Joseph's hope is restored, and he gives us hope. So Joseph was a great dad. He dealt with shame, rejection, good and bad, and hope. So that Jesus and Mary could be home, and that we would have a home. Home is where Jesus is. Home is connected to Jesus. I want to show you a clip that I love because, again, it's about being home. And one of the great metaphors, I think, in pictures is soldiers coming home. And it's kind of like what it's like when we are home where we belong. And that is with Jesus. But sometimes it's just being with your dad that makes home come alive. Watch this.
With Daddy Bear? You love Daddy Bear?
Yeah, and I miss him.
You miss Daddy? Oh, how much do you love your daddy? That much? Do you know we get to see him very soon? Are you so excited? What are you going to do when you see him?
I'm
tired of just in fun. I say to you, come home, 'cause I've been waiting for you for so long, and right now there's a war between the vanities, but all I see is you and me, and the fight for you is all I've ever known, so come.
Here very, very shortly. It's going to arrive on the opposite side of where I'm at, between the memorial and the parking lot. So
the world ain't half as bad as they paint it to be. If for the sons, all the daughters stop to take it in. Well, hopefully the hate subsides and the love can begin. It might start now, yeah. Well, maybe I'm just dreaming out loud. Well, until then, come home, come home. Cause I've been waiting for you for so long, for so long. Right now there's a war between us.
Home for Christmas. I want to be home. And I want to suggest to you this morning that being home is to be connected to Jesus. Whether you're Henry Wadsworth Longfellow and you're trying to work through the tragedy that you're going through or just life in general, home is about Jesus. Now, I usually have a diagram that I show, but because of time, I'm going to have to hold off on the diagram. If you want to know the diagram, you send me an email. It's on the notes, and I'll draw the diagram out and send it back to you. But I want to suggest to you that the only way to really be home is to be connected to Jesus. And we put our faith in Jesus. We are home for eternity. John chapter 1 says this, but whoever, he came to his own people, but they didn't want him. But whoever did want him, who believed he was who he claimed and would do what he said, he made to be their true selves, their child of God selves. And these are the God-begotten, not blood-gotten, not flesh-gotten, not sex-gotten. In your study Bible, it says, not born of blood, which would be your last name. You know, just because I'm a Harden, I'm home. No. The will of the flesh. No. You just can't make yourself better. That's not the way you become a child of God. I'm going to be better. No. And then in the third phrase in your study Bible, it says, by the will of man that somebody says that you're home. No. The way you become a child of God is simply by putting your faith in God's provision, and his provision is Jesus. Baby Jesus, manly Jesus, death on a cross Jesus, resurrection Jesus. I have a friend of mine that died several years ago, Denny Gilbert, and he knew he was dying of cancer. And at 2 a.m. in the morning on September the 27th, he knew that he was losing his battle with cancer, but he knew that he would be home with the Lord. But he wanted his friends and family to know the peace of Jesus. And so he wrote a letter. This is the letter he wrote. And there's a note here. This is his copy of what he wrote. And he wrote it at 2 a.m. in the morning. I want to read it to you. This is what my friend Denny wrote at 2 a.m. in the morning. And 6 weeks later, he was home with Jesus. If it is my good friend, Phil Harden, standing before you reading this letter, please take comfort in the fact that I am at peace resting with my Heavenly Father, and the pain and suffering has forever ended. It has been our prayer for the past 30-some years that I would always leave a trail of love behind me, that others would know they had somehow had an encounter with God through me, that they had been loved by God through me, especially you, my children, especially you. And then you might experience the same relationship with God as I have. Every birthday candle I blew out had the same wish, that you would come to know my Savior as yours, that you would receive the gift of eternal life, that you might be born again and live forever in peace. In the book of the prophet Jeremiah 29:11-13, which says, I have a future for you, and you will find me when you seek me with all your heart. The promise is you will find God. Well, look no further. He is here now waiting to welcome you into a living relationship with him. If we look deep, we all have a void in our hearts, a void I believe only God can fill and wants to fill. I pray my life and now my death will have played a role in such a purpose. I know it takes faith, what may seem a giant leap for you, but that too is a free gift from God. He's waiting to give it freely. You think about that. I read that at Denny's funeral. He asked me to read that. And when I finished reading that, I shared the gospel that the only way to heaven, to truly be home, was to simply put our faith in Jesus. And we prayed a prayer. And after I said amen, I held up 2 pennies. I'd been carrying 2 pennies all morning. And I said, what I want you to do, if you prayed that prayer and did business with Jesus, I want you simply to come up and give me a penny as just an indicator that you put your faith in Jesus as the ultimate gift. And that morning, 17 of Denny's friends and family gave me a penny, and I carry this little Altoid box around with me everywhere I go, Denny's pennies. This morning, I want to invite you to do business with Jesus on whatever level that means. If you've never put your faith in Jesus, I want you to put your faith in Jesus. If you just want to kind of reboot and say, you know, I want 2020 to be my best year of peace, and I know that only as I walk with Jesus will that happen. I want you to do business with Jesus. I'm going to pray a prayer, and after I close in prayer, I have a pile of pennies, and I'll provide the pennies. What I want you to do is I just want you to come up before you leave and put a penny in the tin box. It's just a way to solidify that you did business with Jesus. But if you do business with Jesus, I want to ask you to do 2 things. I want you to write down what that means. I did business with Jesus today, December the 19th, and this is what that meant. I received Jesus for the first time, or I just want to walk with Jesus. I want Jesus to be a bigger part of my life. And then I want you to tell somebody. You can tell your dad, or dad, you can tell your son or your daughter. Maybe you need to do business with Jesus. So I'm going to pray a prayer, and we'll just close. I want you to do business with Jesus. So come up. And then what I want to invite you to do, and I've never done this, I want you to, if you put a penny in the box, I want you to take a penny, 2 pennies. You put one in the box I provide, and then you take one that I provide and you keep it someplace. Put it in your journal, put it in your Bible, frame it, hang it up, and let it be a reminder of the business that you did with Jesus on this day. Let's pray. Father, we bow our heads to acknowledge that we are needy, that we have failed. We feel the pain of the world. We feel the chaos of the world. In the Bible, you call that sin, either things that we've done that we're ashamed of or things that have been done to us that are hurtful and harmful. And Father, we know that you sent Jesus at Christmas, at this time of year, to be a provision for our need for forgiveness and the promise of being home in eternity with you forever. Father, we do business with you this morning. We thank you and we receive Jesus afresh into our hearts. Thank you for your provision. Thank you for your forgiveness. Thank you for being home in eternity with you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd ask you as we close, just come up and put a penny in the box. Take one home. Thanks for being here. Have a Merry Christmas.